Hi, everyone. I'm Micaela Schweitzer-Bluhm, the diplomat in residence for the Department of State for the Northwest region, and I am here today with my colleague, Scott.
Good morning, everyone. My name is Scott Smith. I'm the diplomat in residence for the Rocky Mountain region. And today, what we'd like to do is talk to you a little bit about opportunities at the Department of State. We'll start out by talking about careers, and then later on, we'll move into a discussion of a few opportunities for students that happen to be watching today.
And just to give you some context, it is January 2021. So if you're watching this during this period, all of the information is current. But if you're watching this at a later date, we really strongly recommend that you go to our website, careers.state.gov, and look at the latest information.
Great. So let's go ahead and get started. We'll talk briefly about the U.S. Department of State. We are the nation's oldest cabinet agency. And as you know, we're the leading agency for foreign affairs at the federal level. We lead diplomatic engagement. We are very concerned about US citizens overseas. And we've been around since 1789. So we've got a couple centuries doing this. There's about 77,000 people that work at the US Department of State, and they fit into a couple of different categories. And you can see them listed there on the left-hand side of the slide. There are about 13 or 14,000 foreign service officers. And this is the job that many people think of right away when they think of the US Department of State. These are people that are living and working permanently stationed overseas to work on international affairs for the federal government. There are about 8,000 generalists and almost 6,000 specialists. We'll talk in more detail about that in just a bit. There are about 10,000 civil service employees. Civil service employees also work on international affairs, just like the rest of the Department of State, but they are, for the most part, based in the Washington, D.C. area. There are a limited number of State Department offices around the country. We have diplomatic security bureaus. We have passport agencies that are located outside of the D.C. area, but statistically speaking, the majority of our civil service employees are going to be in the D.C. area. There's 200 or 300 consular fellows that work with the Department of State. We will also talk about consular fellows. They focus on things like visa interviews and American citizen services at our embassies and consulates overseas. There are a few thousand eligible family members also who work with the department. Eligible family members typically are the spouses of foreign service officers. So these are people who are living overseas with their spouse who is a foreign service officer and who are employed at the embassy or consulate where they are located. There's also about 50,000 non-US citizens, overseas locally employed staff that work for the US Department of State. So for example, these would be Bulgarians who are working at our embassy in Bulgaria or Japanese citizens who work at our embassy in Tokyo. So you can see by the numbers that actually there are more non-US citizens working for the Department of State than there are American citizens. And the first group that actually, we'll talk a little bit about Foreign Service career. First of all, Foreign Service is a career that, honestly speaking, after 19 years in the department, I can't imagine having done anything else. It's been a fantastic job, I have to say right up front. Your work is purposeful. You're working on behalf of the American people, on behalf of your country, and it's dynamic. It changes. Not only does it change from year to year or post to post, it can change from month to month, from week to week, or even day to day. It's a very, very engaging career. You work with a really great group of people. And as we talked about in the previous slide, you know, there are many Americans that you'll be working with on a day-to-day basis, but there's also a lot of foreign nationals. So the experience is very, very enriching. You typically spend 2 to 3 years in a specific job. So for example, you might start your career working in Rome for 2 years, and then you might rotate to Cairo for another 2 years, then it might be time to rotate back to the United States. This will go on throughout your career. You will constantly be moving around the world. For the most part, you'll be staying overseas, but there is always the opportunity to come back to the United States, most of those jobs being in the Washington, D.C. area. The first two tours that you do in the Foreign Service are what we call directed. Foreign service officers have a certain amount of influence over where they go, but they do not have complete influence. And especially for your first two tours, the influence over where you end up serving, you do have the ability to express interest, but you will not have a final say. Once you get to mid-level, so third tour and on, you will have a lot more opportunity to guide your own career. The first two tours, though, are pretty well directed by the department. Part and parcel of this job is learning. You will have the opportunity to do professional training, language training, and all of this you'll be doing while you are receiving your salary. So you can be in training full-time, learning a skill or a language that you use at your next tour, but you'll be receiving a paycheck for doing it. So it's a great, great perk, I think, of the job. The performance-based promotions, this is an up or out system. So you will be evaluated on an annual basis. And the expectation is that to remain in the Foreign Service, you need to consistently be demonstrating that you can take on additional responsibility and therefore be promoted to higher and higher levels. This is, once you get into the mid-level, something that that you do your entry level as well as mid-level, but in entry level, we have something what's called tenure. Tenure needs to happen within the first several years of you being in the Department of State, and you have to demonstrate proficiency in a foreign language, and you have to demonstrate that you have the capability to serve at mid-level and above. So you need to obtain tenure first, early on in your career, and then throughout, you need to consistently be promoted over the course of the career to remain in the department. The first job that we will talk about today is Foreign Service Officer Generalist positions. This is sort of the traditional diplomatic corps. The Foreign Service Officers represent the United States overseas. The Foreign Service Officer Generalists are broken into five different career tracks. And these career tracks indicate a specific kind of work that we expect you to do for the department. When you come into the Foreign Service, actually before you come into the Foreign Service, one of the first things you need to do when you're registering is choose a career track. So this is a very important decision that you will take before you even become a Foreign Service officer. So it's important to check the website. There are a variety of resources available online that can help to flesh out a little bit about each of these career tracks. It is a very important decision. You can see them listed there on the slide: consular, economic, management, political, and public diplomacy. Consular officers, what I often say is they deal with people who have moved back and forth across a border in one way or another. For example, foreign nationals who are overseas who want to come to the United States, be it to settle permanently, maybe they married an American citizen, or be it for a temporary experience, maybe a vacation, a business trip, or they want to study abroad in the USA, they will go to the embassy or consulate to obtain a visa, and that interview will occur with a consular officer. So these are foreign nationals crossing a border to come to the United States. Vice versa is also true. Americans who have crossed a border and who find themselves overseas for one of those reasons, business trip, studying abroad, taking a trip. If they have an issue while they are overseas, for example, God forbid there's a medical issue, if you lose your passport, those American citizens will go to an embassy or consulate and again, speak with a consular officer. So consular deals with the movement of people across borders. Economic is the second, and I'll also cover political kind of simultaneously, the fourth. Those two career tracks cover exactly what the names imply. Economic officers are interested in what is going on in terms of the economy, labor, environment, trade, what's happening in the country where the economic officer is posted. Political officers do similar work. They look at political trends, specific political parties, candidates, legal structures, et cetera, in the country where they are serving for the Foreign Service. So economic and political officers are observing these trends in the countries where they are, and they report back to Washington to let Washington know what's going on in the economy, what's going on in the political sphere in those countries. And that information is used in Washington to make policy decisions. If Washington has a message they would like to have communicated in the country where an econ or political officer is posted, for example, right now we're under a new administration and there are some new guidelines coming out. Those requests for communication of a message come from Washington to the economic or political officers in the countries, and they will meet with their counterparts in the host government. So econ and political officers throughout the course of their careers will focus on those two specific issues. The third, management. These are similar to chief operating officers. These are the people who make sure that the embassies and consulates overseas are up and running and functioning very, very well. They take care of things like human resources. They manage the finances for embassies and consulates. They do procurement and general services. They manage the motor pool fleet. They manage our properties. These are things that our management colleagues do. So if you're interested in serving in a capacity like that, management is a very, very kind of interesting thing to consider as you're looking at career tracks. Finally, public diplomacy. Public diplomacy is the career track that focuses on connecting with the local nationals, with the people in the country where you are serving. We do this in a couple of different ways. One way is by working with the media. Public diplomacy officers make sure that local journalists, that local media have updated, accurate information about the United States, its history, its policies, so that the United States is portrayed accurately in local media, so that locals, when they read the newspaper or see TV, get the correct information about the United States. We also manage a number of different kinds of programs, English language programs. We have cultural programs that we manage. We manage exchange programs. For example, if you've ever heard of the Fulbright program, this is a program that our public diplomacy officers manage as part of their day-to-day work overseas. So these are the five career tracks. There's a lot of information online. Give it some serious thought, because once you do choose a career track and come into the Foreign Service, the expectation is that you will serve the majority of your career in the career track which you have selected.
Great, thanks, Scott. I'm gonna focus now on the other half of the Foreign Service, our Foreign Service Specialist Career Corps. And while Foreign Service generalists or officers are hired for their general knowledge, Foreign Service specialists are hired for their specialized knowledge, as the title implies. And we have a number of fantastic positions across a really wide range of positions. So I'm gonna spend a little bit of time going through some of those. First, I wanna talk about the specialist positions that are STEM related. As you can see here, we hire folks across information technology, engineering, medical expertise. Let me go into some of that a little bit. Our IT management specialists are responsible for all of our data and communication networks, both our unclassified and our classified. They're responsible for the security, the integrity of those. They're also responsible for looking at what technology is out there and how technology can better be applied to our work set. How can we innovate to do what we're doing better? They are also responsible for any kind of crisis communication networks that we maintain. So a big job, very important to our global organization. We have over 270 different locations. So without that kind of communication and connectivity, we're really lost. I would say too, a lot of folks with an IT background really enjoy coming into work in the Department of State, because folks that have an IT background can get leadership and management responsibility quite a bit earlier in their career than they might in the private sector. And so it really gives you an opportunity to innovate and to lead and to manage. On the engineering side, we bring in folks to work on both our security side of our house as well as on our building side of the house. Our security engineering officers, our security technical specialists are responsible for all of the systems in an embassy or a consulate that ensure both the physical and the technical security of that embassy or consulate, protecting our people and our information. They're responsible for maintaining those systems and for designing new systems to meet whatever kind of risks or threats are identified. Our building engineers are responsible for looking at all of our 270 different facilities around the world and identifying where there's renovations, where we need to do replacement projects. They oversee any kind of building project from design to build to launch. They're responsible for every aspect of that, including coordinating with local authorities on that. And then our medical professionals. One of the things we'll talk about later on, we talk about some of the benefits of the job beyond the purposeful work and the great colleagues and the professional opportunities. One of the benefits is that we have fantastic medical care. All of our American employees and American families overseas are cared for by our Department of State Medical Services. So we hire doctors, psychiatrists, nurse practitioners, physician assistants, and lab specialists to work in our medical division. It's an incredibly important job, and we're always looking for good folks who have an adventurous spirit to come and join our medical division. We also have specialist positions that are in more of our business operations field. Scott talked a little bit about our management officer position, which really are our global business managers. And we also hire folks who have very specialized skills in various management and business capacities. So if you have an expertise in finance or in HR, if you're a supply chain expert, if you have facility management expertise or office management expertise, we're looking for you to come and join our organization and to help make our global business run. Global diplomacy is a big business. We want to make sure that we have a successful platform and operation, and we really need experts in each of these fields to come in and work with us. Likewise, we have some unique opportunities in our specialist career that don't really fit into other categories, so we like to talk about them a little bit separately. On our security side, we hire folks as diplomatic security special agents. DS special agents are law enforcement officers. They have specific responsibilities for the integrity of our visas and our passports. But they have bigger responsibilities in the Department of State. They're responsible for all of our security programs related to our people and our facilities around the world. They're also responsible for cooperating on international investigations, maybe on people trafficking, on fraud issues, counterterrorism, a lot of different variety of investigations that they cooperate on. They're also responsible for security diplomacy, so promoting the rule of law, promoting training of security forces overseas to try and enhance cooperation, to enhance integrity, to enhance accountability. Our diplomatic couriers within this security division are responsible for making sure that our protected information, our protected materials, our protected equipment can move around the world securely. So we're always looking for good folks that have that integrity and an interest in seeing the world. So check out those careers. On the public diplomacy side, we hire specialists in two categories to work with our public diplomacy division, specifically on our English language teaching programs and on our outreach programs. So our regional public engagement specialists are responsible for working with all of our public diplomacy sections in our embassies around the world to develop outreach programs. Maybe it's working with young people, maybe it's doing outreach to specific communities in a country. Our regional English language officers are just that, folks who have a specific specialized background in English language teaching, who can help advise and develop our English language curriculums and outreach programs.
I mentioned this just briefly earlier, but let's go into a little bit more detail about the Consular Fellows Program. As you might remember earlier, I mentioned that the consular section in the embassy deals with people who have crossed a border. Maybe they've come for a visa interview, or it's an American citizen who needs a service provided at the embassy. We do hire consular fellows. So these are people that will specialize in consular work. We require them to have one of the following four languages. You can see them there on the screen: Portuguese, Mandarin, Spanish, or Arabic. So if you are a candidate who speaks one of those languages, you could qualify for the Consular Fellows Program. Now, there's an important kind of asterisk we need to put on this. The Consular Fellows Program is not a full-time foreign service position. By that I mean, although you are working full-time at the embassy in the consular section, this is a maximum 5-year appointment. It's what we call a limited non-career appointment. So you can be a consular fellow for a maximum of 5 years. That limit is in the regulations, hard on paper. But if you speak one of these languages, it's a great way to have access to a group of jobs that are not accessible to other people who don't speak these languages. If you happen to speak another language, if you speak Italian, if you speak Korean, that's great. And we welcome those languages in the Foreign Service. Unfortunately, those languages do not qualify under the Consular Fellows Program. Consular Fellows, as it says on the slide, is focused exclusively on Portuguese, Mandarin, Spanish, and Arabic. Another unique aspect of the Consular Fellows Program is that, unlike the Foreign Service, you will not serve in the United States as a consular fellow. consular fellows serve exclusively overseas. So foreign service officers do have the opportunity to come back to the United States. Consular fellows do not. We're hiring you for your language skills, and that's why we want to make sure that we're using those skills in an overseas setting. So you'll be stationed at an embassy or consulate overseas. In the blue field there on the slide, you can see pretty much what they do. They offer visa services, American citizen services, and there are other duties that do come up just that are part and parcel of being part of the embassy community. Maybe you end up working on a VIP visit. Maybe you end up working on specific committees or other activities that are happening in the embassy. But the focus of your job is going to be in the consular section, and really we want you to use those language skills in Portuguese, Chinese, Spanish, or Arabic. So what we want to talk about next is just a little bit about the benefits. And I alluded to it earlier. I said, you know, this is a great career. I can't imagine having done anything else. Some of the nitty-gritty stuff, though, that you might want to think about when you're considering a career in the Foreign Service. There are different ways that your salary can be augmented, and these are typically dependent on where it is that you're serving in the world. While you're in the United States, there's what we call locality pay. So there will be a salary adjustment to your base salary that is based on the cost of living in the area where you're working, be it in DC, New York, et cetera, et cetera. Overseas, there are a couple of different ways that your salary can be bumped up. Hardship pay, these are in places that are particularly difficult and present some sort of challenge in day-to-day life and work. Danger pay, specifically if there's a threat, for example, in places in Iraq historically has had danger pay. COLA, cost of living adjustments, can also help to bump up your salary. For example, in Tokyo and Switzerland, in places where the cost of living is very, very high, there is an additional COLA, cost of living adjustment, that's added to your salary. We do offer a student loan repayment program. This is a great way to help offset some of the student loans that you might come out of college with. There is a specific list of places around the world where if you serve, you are eligible to apply for the student loan repayment program. I myself benefited from it. And over the course of 3 years, I had a chunk of the principal on my student loans paid by the government. For no other reason than I was showing up, doing the job, and committed to remaining in the Foreign Service for a certain period of time. Retirement benefits are also really, really good in the federal government. You might have heard this said before. Federal jobs provide a certain level of security that's really, really attractive. The Thrift Savings Plan is our 401k. There are matching contributions up to a specific limit that the department makes for you. That's on top of whatever it is that you contribute. Insurance is really, really good. Life, health, vision, and dental. One of the key things about insurance is so long as you serve for a certain amount of time, typically 20 years, and retire at the age of 50 or older, you can carry your insurance into retirement even after you've separated from the Foreign Service. This is something that's unlike a lot of private sector positions. And so it's a big benefit, I think, with the Department of State. While you're overseas, your house is paid for. So you're not going to pay for rent while you're overseas. The embassy will identify and then pay for housing for you and your family. And on family, it's important to remember that the expectation throughout your career in the Foreign Service is that your family will accompany you. Now, there will be specific places around the world, and you will know these in advance, where your family cannot go with you. For example, Baghdad. Your family will not be able to travel with you to Baghdad. But for the majority of your career, it's pretty likely you will be in places where your family, spouse, and children are expected to be with you there at post. And part of that is the housing, but also an important part for kids is that while you're serving overseas, the kids who are K through 12 get their education paid for. These are typically international schools in the city where you are living and working, and the quality of education overseas can be very, very good, on top of the fact that your children can grow up in an intercultural environment, perhaps learning an additional language or two. These relocation expenses as you travel around the world are covered. These are not expenses that we pay out of pocket. So when you and your family move, transportation is paid for, the moving expenses are paid for, all of that is covered by the Department of State. Annual and sick leave is provided. There are some kinds of specific leave that are also provided at specific points in your career. Home leave, for example, is a kind of vacation leave that we get between overseas postings. R&R is a special travel benefit that we get while we are at hardship tours overseas. You might get one or perhaps two round trip tickets paid for to take rest and recuperation travel departing your overseas assignment. Spousal employment programs, I mentioned this briefly earlier about the eligible family members. There are programs both overseas and domestically that can help to locate employment for your spouse. Overseas, a lot of those happen to be at the embassy or consulate, and it's something that a lot of Foreign Service officers take advantage of and find quite attractive. Also, just I think the community in the Foreign Service. Foreign Service, you know, there's only about 8,000 Foreign Service officer generalists and about 5,000 specialists. So 13,000 of us is like a small town. And we end up serving all over the world. And over the course of 15 or 20 years, you cross paths with a lot of people, multiple times perhaps. You really get to know your colleagues. And while you're at post, if you're in a place overseas, the community within that post oftentimes is extremely tight-knit and very supportive. We're all going through many of the same challenges, be it trying to figure out how to get a child a good education overseas, or how to travel with your pet, or where should I go for my next job. You have a whole community of people that you can rely upon for that information because they've all been through it as well. So I found the community in the Foreign Service to be a very, very important aspect of the job. We'll talk a little bit about the dimensions of Foreign Service candidates. So we've talked about what the jobs are. Question is, how do you get these jobs? What are we looking for? What are we assessing, right? First and foremost, it's important to say all of the positions that we've talked about up to this point require U.S. citizenship. This is a fundamental basic requirement for all of our positions. Now, each position, generalists, the different specialist positions, will have different criteria. If you're an engineer, if you're a generalist, you'll come in with different KSAs, knowledge, skills, and abilities, and educational requirements. But fundamentally for the generalists, specifically for the generalists, what we're measuring through a multi-step intake process, and that process is spelled out on the website, what we're measuring is what we call the dimensions of Foreign Service candidates. There are 13 of them for Foreign Service Officer Generalists. Now, if you take a step back and think about what does a Foreign Service Officer Generalist do? A generalist advocates on behalf of the United States, essentially. So for someone who is in an advocacy position, what kind of qualities, what kind of attributes, what kind of characteristics make a person a strong advocate? I would say that the 13 dimensions, which are on the screen right now, are characteristics that do lead to a successful advocacy career: composure, cultural adaptability, strong communication skills, experience and motivation, resourcefulness, quantitative analysis. These are things that make for a person to be a strong advocate. And these are the things that we're actually assessing throughout the generalist intake process. Now for specialists, again, they will have specific criteria in terms of qualifications for application, but the specialists also need to demonstrate the dimensions. There is one, however, that has an asterisk: quantitative analysis. For specialist positions, we do not evaluate that specific dimension in the intake process. And there's a reason for that. Typically built into the requirements for specialist jobs through the educational requirements, through the years of professional experience that we require, that quantitative analysis is already demonstrated. So there's no need to explicitly evaluate that for specialists. So the dimensions, there are 13 for generalists, 12 for specialists, and they're all available on the website as well as a step-by-step intake process for the job that you might be interested in.
So let's talk about that step-by-step intake process. And I'm going to go through it in a little bit more detail, and then I'm going to talk a little bit about how you might be able to prepare for it. So as Scott said, there is a multi-tiered evaluation process for both generalists and specialists. It starts with you identifying which position you want to apply for. Do you want to apply for a generalist position, and in which track? Do you want to apply for a specialist position? Which one? I should say at this point, you can have multiple applications going with the Department of State at the same time. So you could apply for a couple of different specialist positions if you qualify. You could apply for a generalist position and a specialist position. that's totally fine with us. As long as you're interested and you have the personality that fits with the Foreign Service, we want your expertise. So after you've decided which position or career track you want to apply in, you submit your application. And I, especially on the specialist positions, I really encourage you to take a look at the eligibility requirements very carefully. Some of them have quite specific education and experience requirements. For example, some of our engineering positions, there's very specific requirements. So make sure that you've read through those and that you actually meet those requirements. Similarly, our medical positions, there are pretty specific requirements in terms of your degree and how you, in what fields you got your experience and how many years of experience you have. So definitely read through those eligibility requirements pretty carefully. When you submit your application, we are going to ask you to submit along with that several what we call personal narratives. These are 6 short essays, no more than 350 words, that ask you to give us examples of when you've exhibited those 13 dimensions. So it could be leadership, communication, management skills, all these different things. We ask you to give us specific examples and tell us about how you applied your skills. What skills did you apply? Those essays are very important, and I'll come back to that in a minute. Once you've submitted your application, then your candidacy, depending on which position you're applying for, is going to go through a different process. So some positions involve a test. Foreign Service Generalist Officer candidates must take the Foreign Service Officer test, which is a general knowledge test. It covers a wide array of subjects: economics, politics, world history, constitution, culture. You have to take that test before you can move on to the next phases. Some of the specialist positions also involve a test. Our information management specialists must take a test up front. Diplomatic security special agents also take a threshold test up front. So you go through those tests. People who are not going through a test also go through a technical evaluation. So your application is first going to go through a review to see whether or not you meet those technical eligibility requirements that we've laid out in the position announcement. So once everybody goes through that, if you get your threshold score on the test, if you meet the technical eligibility requirements, then you're going to move on to the next phase, which is what we call the qualifications evaluation panel. That's where your personal narratives are going to come back in a big way. We're going to be a panel of examiners are going to look at your application. They're going to read your essays. For Foreign Service Officer candidates, they're going to also look at the written essays that you do as part of the Foreign Service Officer test. And they're going to be scoring all of that against those dimensions that Scott just talked about. If you get the threshold score again on the qualification evaluation panel, as they look at your whole package, then you'll be invited to the oral assessment, which is a day-long in-person evaluation process in which we put you through a few different exercises to, again, elicit those dimensions. Do you have those qualities that we're looking for, those attributes that we're looking for? The only folks that are required to take a language test, and this precedes the oral assessment, are the consular fellows candidates. Consular fellows are being hired, as we discussed, for your language expertise in those 4 languages: Portuguese, Mandarin, Arabic, and Spanish. So we want to know if you have the level of language skills that we're looking for. We're not expecting you to be a proficient native speaker in these languages, but do you have a good base? Do you have a good foundation? So consular fellow candidates have to demonstrate that before they can continue on to the oral assessment phase. So the oral assessment, you'll go through all the exercises during the day. For specialists, it includes a structured interview, some hypothetical situations, a writing exercise. For Foreign Service generalist candidates, it also includes a group exercise. At the end of the day, you're given your score. You're told whether or not you passed or not. At that point, if you've gotten above the threshold score in the oral assessment, then you are given a conditional offer of employment. And that's contingent on getting a medical clearance for worldwide availability and a security clearance for a top secret security clearance. That process can vary in length, but once that is done, your overall package gets one final review by a panel before you are told that you are a successful candidate and placed on what we call the register. This is a list of successful candidates from which we draw to form orientation classes. And everyone in the Foreign Service comes in first to an orientation class. I should say a couple things. This whole process can take 18 to 24 months. It's not a quick process. So don't quit your day job. Keep doing that, but keep trying for this. The wait is worth it. As Scott has said, the career is a fantastic career and it's definitely worth the wait. The other thing that I do want to say is it is a competitive process, and not everybody makes it through the process on their first try. In fact, the majority of people in the Foreign Service currently have applied for their current positions more than once. Some 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, even 9 times I've heard. So if you don't make it through on your first try, please don't be discouraged. Stick with it. Try again. I'm also going to give you some tips on how to prepare. The first thing I'm going to reiterate again is know the requirements for both the generalist positions and the specialist positions. Take some time to read through the information that we have on our website about the positions, what the responsibilities are, and what the requirements for application are. Also know the process. I just went through that 9-step process pretty quickly. We have a lot more detail about those different steps on our website. We also have on our website practice tests. We have guides. If you go to the download section at the top of our website, you'll be connected to a page where you can download different guides to, for example, the Foreign Service Officer test, to the specialist oral assessment process, a lot of different information there that you can access. We also have an app called DOS Careers. This is a great app. One of the best things about it is the test yourself section. For folks that are studying for the Foreign Service Officer test, this is really helpful. It has retired Foreign Service Officer test questions on it, broken down by subject. So they're little quiz packets and you can do the quizzes and get a sense of where your strengths are and where your weaknesses are. And then you can try and focus on those areas. Because it's a general knowledge test, it can be very hard to study for. So it's good to get a sense of where you need to brush up. I would say too, do some research on the institution of the Foreign Service. Know what you're getting into. We have a reading list on our website. Some of the best materials that we refer you to are these books that we've listed here, Career Diplomacy, Inside a U.S. Embassy, Realities of Foreign Service Life. These give you a real sense of what the Foreign Service is about. How do we operate? How do we function? This is really helpful, particularly when you go into the oral assessment for both generalists and specialists. We also encourage you to practice writing. Pretty much at every stage of the application process, we're going to ask you to write, and we're going to be looking at your writing. This is true for both generalists and specialists. So it's a good idea to practice. Just get into the habit of writing short narratives, either about you, about your work, about various topics. Pick whatever you want and just get into the habit of writing. And if you're not ready to apply now or you feel like you need more experience, that's great. One of the things that we do want to make sure you know is, for the most part, there's not one path to the Foreign Service. You can take a multitude of different paths and end up with us. There's not one cookie cutter approach to joining the Foreign Service. Certainly for some of the specialist positions, we are looking for different types of experience, but you can get that experience in a variety of ways. What we are looking for are those dimensions. And so we encourage people to get out, to have different experiences, challenge yourself to grow in new ways, and develop those different dimensions that we're looking for. I will also flag that we do have a couple of different classroom programs that you could also join. Our Global Public Affairs Bureau sponsors the Foreign Policy Classroom, and the National Museum of American Diplomacy has its own diplomacy classroom. The National Museum of American Diplomacy is also a great resource to learn about the Foreign Service. It has some excellent information on its website. I definitely encourage you to look into that as part of your research process for joining the Foreign Service. Before we wrap up, we also want to make sure that we are, if any folks are watching this and you're a student, we want to make sure that you know about our different student opportunities. We have a plethora of student opportunities, internships, fellowships, study abroad programs, really a rich array of opportunities. Our biggest program is our unpaid student internship. And this is open to both undergraduates and graduate students. We offer it in three different cohorts, fall, spring, and summer. It's a 10-week full-time internship. We offer opportunities both in Washington, D.C. and overseas at our embassies and consulates. Our next biggest program, I would say, is our virtual internship. Our virtual student federal service is a great student opportunity that is part-time. It's no more than 10 hours a week throughout an academic year. You apply in July, you're selected in August, and you're off working on your virtual project by September. The reason we can do the virtual internships so fast is because you don't require a security clearance to work on those. Our internship programs, both our unpaid as well as our U.S. Foreign Service internship program, which is a unique two-summer internship program that is a paid internship, those do require security clearances. And so the application for those is quite far in advance, generally about 9 months before you would start the application. Just before you would start the internship, you need to submit your application. There are a couple of others that I'll flag here. Pathways, we have Pathways Recent Graduate Program. This is a great program if you're interested in a path into the civil service in particular. Likewise, the Presidential Management Fellowship, if you are pursuing an advanced degree, that's a great way to also join federal service. I do want to talk a little bit about the Rangel, Pickering, and Foreign Affairs IT Fellowships. These are all fellowships that are a path into the Foreign Service, specifically intended to help folks from underrepresented communities see a path into the Foreign Service. Pickering and Rangel result in you joining the Foreign Service as a Foreign Service generalist officer. Foreign Affairs IT Fellowship results in you joining as an information management specialist. Pickering and Rangel are specifically for grad school programs. The Foreign Affairs IT Fellowship can be both for undergrad, junior and senior year, or for graduate school. So definitely check those out. Those are all, the Pickering and Rangel you apply for in September, October, and the Foreign Affairs IT Fellowship you apply for no later than the beginning of February. I'm not going to go into a ton of detail on our study abroad language programs, but please check them out. They are great opportunities to get experience and exposure overseas. The Fulbright programs, as Scott mentioned earlier, one of our favorite flagship programs. So visit our website, check all those out, and let us know if you have questions. And speaking of letting us know if you have questions, Scott and I are both diplomats in residence. We're only two of 16. We have diplomats in residence who are all over the country. We're broken down into regions. So please reach out to your diplomat in residence. We are here to answer your questions. We want to help you navigate this whole field, the whole process of applying. We want to help mentor you through that application process and help you figure out which job might be the right fit for you in the Foreign Service. You can find all of us, and you can actually shoot us emails via our website, careers.state.gov. So definitely reach out to us. Reach out to the DIR that's in your region where you're going to school or where you're from originally. If you're overseas, you're welcome to reach out to any of us. But again, as Scott mentioned, we're looking for good folks who have an adventurous spirit, who have a wide range of skills. You do have to have U.S. citizenship, natural born, naturalized, dual citizenship, all that's great, but that is a requirement. And we hope that you will be in touch. We hope you've enjoyed this presentation and that you found it useful, and we'll look forward to hearing from you soon.